So I thought I'd get started. And actually, I think probably for this first question, it could either be Dr. Rabinovich or Dr. Weiner. The issue that, Gil, you were talking about with the combined A-beta and tau spinal tap, that now we're at the point where we could theoretically go in and find out if we have these changes in our spinal tap. How available is that? Is that still one of these things that we talk about it here and then we realize, but you can't actually get this in real life. You can only get it through a specific trial in a university like UCSF. Where are we at with that type of testing?
Sure. I'm happy to take that. And I'll answer about spinal fluid tests, but also about amyloid PET scans. So in terms of spinal fluid tests, there is a commercial lab that does offer the amyloid and tau measures of CSF. I think one issue, and I think Mike will probably agree with me about the reliability of those tests, is that there are seem to be a lot of different factors that can perturbate and change, particularly the levels of amyloid in the spinal fluid and to some degree tau, and that standardizing those measures in the spinal fluid so that if you send the same sample from the same patient, for example, to lab one versus lab two, you'll get very similar results. That remains a challenge to the field, and that's something that there's a lot of work on right now. And similarly, establishing what is a normal level versus what is an abnormal level, there's still some work that needs to be done there. So the answer is yes, this is commercially available. I think the reliability of the clinical test still suffers from some of these issues of standardization. And so still, I think more work needs to be done for this to really be a viable clinical test, in my personal opinion. Amyloid PET scans, there are now three different amyloid PET tracers that have been approved by the FDA for clinical use, so this is also available to patients. The problem is that insurance does not cover these PET scans, and Medicare actually issued a decision earlier this year stating that more work is needed to try to establish how useful these scans are in terms of diagnosing and managing patients and whether they truly affect the course of the disease and the outcomes in the patients. So you should look forward to some of these studies. Probably a registry type of study will open up that will allow access to patients. But for now, patients have to pay out of pocket and the tests are very expensive, you know, $3,000 to $5,000. So access is really limited to most people. I don't know if Mike wants to add to any of that.
Great, thank you. So I'm curious about some of the ethical issues that you've been facing as you're doing this research. I know, Gil, you mentioned that you were sharing in one of the studies I think you presented, you talked about people knowing their amyloid status. In other words, knowing that I have a brain full of beta amyloid, but I don't have any symptoms, and actually letting people know that, or letting them know their E4 status. And it seems like things are changing a little bit. For a long time, it was, if you participated in research, you really didn't find out these things. But it seems like that's changing a bit. I wonder if you could comment on that, and how you're handling that with the work that you're doing. Maybe, Mike, you could start with that.
In most research, we don't provide the results of research results to the subjects or their families unless they are considered to be clinically significant. So if you're in a research project and somebody, God forbid, should discover a brain tumor or multiple sclerosis, of course you would be told. But a lot of the data that we get in research is really not clear what you do with it clinically. In fact, right now, even if you know somebody's got amyloid in their brain versus not having amyloid in their brain, exactly what is the clinical implication, the practical clinical implication of that is under debate. So I think that what we are concerned about in research is if you tell somebody what their status is, it's going to affect the way they feel. A patient might get depressed, for example, if you tell them they got a brain full of amyloid. So then you have a situation where the results are affecting the study. Now, with the particular study that Gil talked about, which is called the A4 study, it's a prevention trial, and only people who have amyloid in their brain can be enrolled in the study. That is the definition. They're only including people who have amyloid in their brain. So by the nature of the study, they had to work out a way to inform people whether or not they have amyloid in their brain. And when the people first enroll and sign informed consent, they're told that you will be given those results. But this is a new step, It's not something that's done widely right now. And I think that all of this is going to change when we have effective treatments to slow the progression of Alzheimer's disease. But right now, since there's nothing really you can do about if you knew you had amyloid in your brain, the prevailing feeling in medicine, as my own feeling, is that there's no reason to tell people. And certainly, you know, if you have amyloid in your brain, you're at a higher risk for future decline as a group, statistically speaking. But there are some people with a lot of amyloid in their brain who don't decline and who get sick and die of something else. So it's by no means a certainty what these implications mean. And since there's no treatment outcome, we're just not, this kind of data is not released.
Okay.
Yeah, just to I agree with Mike, just to elaborate a little bit. So for example, the study that's being undertaken in Colombia has taken a different approach, because there, the Kindred, with the where, remember, there's 5,000 people and probably a third of them have a mutation that causes Alzheimer's, they really did not want to know what their mutation status is in the family. They did not want to know if they have the mutation or not. And so the approach of that study is to actually enroll anyone who's at risk, who's in the Kindred, and those individuals who are found to not carry the mutation are given placebo. And so, you know, different prevention studies may have different strategies. Since amyloid imaging is a clinically approved test at this point, what we do at UCSF is we do disclose results to people who have objectively confirmed cognitive impairment. If they meet criteria for MCI or dementia and they're in our studies and they want to know their amyloid status, we do disclose that. We think that that is, you know, fair enough for their participation. We absolutely do not disclose results to individuals who are not cognitively impaired or who have subjective complaints, but these are not confirmed by tests, outside of this one exception, which is the prevention trial, the A4 trial that Mike mentioned.
Great, thank you. We have a number of questions for Chris around CTE, so I'm going to bundle a couple of them together. What do you say to individuals who ask you about treatments? I know that you said we don't know much about it, but what's that conversation look like? I actually was in a position of speaking to retired NFL players, and that was, of course, one of the top questions is, okay, so I know I'm at risk. What do I do about it now at this point? And if I do start to develop CTE, what treatments are available? Do Alzheimer's treatments help? Do we know if they help someone with CTE?
I'll give a fast answer, and then actually with Dr. Abinovich, I know treating former NFL players, I don't know, Dr. Weiner is. I mean, the simple answer is, you know, there's no disease-modifying treatment, just like Alzheimer's disease. There are things that can help you live better. You know, you need to go see a specialist and then hope that they have some appreciation for the nuanced differences is really the idea. So we try to give you, you know, tell you, be an active patient. You can, you know, feel better, live better. And I'll hand it off for the specifics if you'd like to discuss that.
Absolutely. I think there's a lot we can do, actually, to help the NFL players. First and foremost, we can treat the depression, which can be fulminant and, you know, lead to suicide, as Chris said. And I think this is a way to for NFL players to get help and get treated for depression. They suffer often very disabling headaches that are amenable to treatment. And actually, their quality of life and even some of the cognitive symptoms can improve with effective headache treatment. There are sleep disorders. And so there are many, many different symptoms that we can treat and treat very effectively. In terms of the Alzheimer's drugs, you know, there really are no data to say whether they work or not. There are some commonalities. For example, the areas of the brain that lead to loss of acetylcholine, which is the transmitter that is addressed by Aricept and similar medications, does seem to be affected in CTE. So there is some, at least, rationale to think that there might be changes in acetylcholine in CTE that might be amenable to treatments like Aricept. And so in some of the older players who have symptoms that seem like Alzheimer's disease, I'm not averse, if they're interested in trying a medication like that, to see if it will help them and improve their symptoms a bit. But this is entirely off-label and not scientific, not data-driven.
Okay, thank you. Again, related to CTE, there are a lot of questions about helmets. And do helmets make a difference in terms of preventing concussions and kind of practical issues like that?
Sure. The helmet issue is sort of nuanced. So, and it has a lot to do with what you're using it in. So if you're, for example, like in a motorcycle and you want to wear a helmet, it will help you if you're involved in a single traumatic incident. We encourage that use with bicycles and things like that. When you start adding them to sports where they can be used as a weapon, what I think you find historically in America where we've added football helmets and helmets in ice hockey is that you increase the number of blows to the head because the athletes no longer complain and try to prevent you from hitting them in the head because they don't feel that pain anymore that they used to feel on the scalp and with blood. And they don't feel their brain getting rattled around in there. And so, and the helmet industry in general wasn't really hyper-focused on concussions until recently. And so they're, you know, the helmets were there to prevent skull fractures. So the long story short is that helmets are getting better, but there's a dramatic limitation to how much they will be able to help us. Because even if you think of how a helmet's constructed, you know, most of them involve foam or and so, you know, some sort of padding, and that's supposed to absorb energy, but it really only can compress when you're talking about linear acceleration. But the bigger culprit, most scientists believe, with brain injury is rotational acceleration. So if you think about putting a helmet on someone's head and then hitting them from the side and watching that head twist, the helmet doesn't really have an opportunity to reduce any of that force, that acceleration. And so the long story short, helmets are getting better, but we really need to affect rule change because they're never going to be able to prevent all concussions. And in some cases, they're making them worse because the hits are bigger and harder.
And you showed, I think, I didn't recognize it, whether you had any women. When you talked about CTE, it seemed to be largely men. Have you had any cases or known of any cases of women?
The only woman in the literature is the victim of abuse. We have only 3 brains of women out of our 200. I have to fall back on my undergraduate studies. This is, I think, is a bit of a cultural issue in the sense that there weren't a lot of women athletes. This is primarily a football problem. Half our brains are football players. There aren't women in that. And then the other side is with Title IX, there aren't a lot of older women who were, you know, high-profile athletes. And so, and then I think the other half is when I call to get brains, people seem comfortable now with giving away dad's brain or their son's brain, but when I ask about daughters and mothers, like there's a very quick, they're not interested. So I think we have to really open that door up because there's no reason to believe this isn't a similar problem for women.
Great, thank you. Dr. Weiner, I have a number of questions about the Brain Health Registry or comments about online testing. One of the comments was that it is so computer-based. Do you have concerns about that in terms of a bias, perhaps, because it is reliant on people than being capable of using and accessing a computer? Are you concerned that you'll have a skewed group of people?
Oh, there's no question that there are a lot of limitations to this approach. One big limitation is obviously what you would call generalizability. The only people who are going to participate in this are people who have access to computers, can do it online. What's interesting, though, is if you look at all clinical research in general happens to be done, especially in the Alzheimer's field, happens to largely be done on people who have quite a bit of education. There's a lot of concern about underrepresentation of minorities and poorly educated people in all kinds of neuroscience research, especially Alzheimer's research. We are seeking funds that will be directed at internet advertising and going to the Asian, the African American, the Hispanic communities in the Bay Area to try to increase our registration. But we're not, you know, we just want to make it clear, we're not saying that our registry is the end. It's just the beginning. It's a portal. It's not the only way that people should be brought into clinical trials. It's a way to increase the number of people who can come into clinical trials. So it's not going to take away from any other effort. Mm-hmm. And the beauty of it is it's extremely inexpensive. Mm-hmm.
There have been some questions here about the testing then, Lumosity or Cognostate. Is it Cognostate?
Cognostate.
I've done Lumosity. I don't know. How many of you have actually done it? It's a very humbling experience if you haven't done it. You think you're pretty good till you do it, and then you realize I'm not that good. So a couple of questions about that. How reliable are those tests, for example, or Cogstate, when you look at the changes that we all experience as we age in terms of the slow processing and slippage in memory and all that. How do those tests account for normal age-related changes, and how does
that? Right. Well, there's a lot of data on Cogstate. Cogstate's been around for quite a number of years. They've got a lot of publications, and they are very well validated. So what they've done is they've taken people and stuck them in front of computers, and they took the test, and then they had them take other types of very conventional, well-accepted, you could say paper and pencil tests. And Cogstate performance is quite good as a screen for clinical use for and for clinical trials. What I didn't mention during my talk, and what is quite remarkable, is that when we've gotten Cogstate data now, just in 2 months, on over 3,500 subjects, and when we analyzed our data and looked at it as a function of age, the data that we got was exactly the same, exactly down to 2 decimal points, what Cogstate got on its in-clinic, highly supervised and validated tests. So it shows, I was very surprised. I thought the people taking them at home, they're drinking a couple of martinis, their grandchildren are sitting on their lap, the TV is on,
yeah.
They're taking the test. I thought we were going to see a lot more variance in our results. And in fact, I thought the statistician had switched the results. That's how concerned I was. But it turned out that our results are just right on. And the fail rate, that is the number of tests, the percentage, the fail rate is less than 2% of people who start taking the test can't complete it. So I think it's looking actually good, but we're only just beginning. And we need to bring people in from our study and compare the results at home with in clinic. And Johnson & Johnson's already given us a grant to do that. So we're gonna validate the measurement. So it's got promise for the future.
Great. It's interesting. I don't know if any of you have heard about this, but they're developing technology now that sort of senses when you experience change. A keyboard that can actually track, it's a program that can track changes in cadence when you're typing, where you don't even realize you're having any changes, but it just picks up on it.
Right. There's an explosion of devices of all types. Devices that track your sleep, devices that count your steps, devices that measure your metabolism. Some people are making devices that they claim will measure brain waves. And the scientific community, needs to validate and assess how these devices could be used. But I think, for example, in the traumatic brain injury, wouldn't it be amazing if we could just get a whole bunch of young athletes signed up on an internet site where they're taking a cognitive test on some regular basis and reporting when they're playing their games or when they're in practice or how many hits they have. Mm-hmm. We've been talking to the University of Colorado about doing a study with the Brain Health Registry and trying to get their teams involved. And I mean, it's the kind of thing we could work on together. Having an internet site that tracks cognitive performance has tremendous potential to study all kinds of mm-hmm. brain problems in neurology and psychiatry. We're just trying to figure out how to do it.
Great. So one last question for each of you, very briefly. What are you most excited about in your respective field? So when you're at dinner and someone says, hey, what's going on in your area? And what gets you excited about the future? Chris, why don't you start?
So
good to last. Or Gil.
We live in two worlds. We're trying to accelerate treatment for this, trying to prevent it. So I would say, some of the PET scan work to actually be able to diagnose CT living people is what I'm most excited about, because I think it'll just open up the door to even more work being done, more brilliant scientists getting in the field and focusing on this. On the other half, the prevention side, I'm really curious to see where hit count goes. I really think if we can just start letting everyone know to count how many times their kid's whacked in the head, mm-hmm. I think that'll put a lot of pressure on people to go, maybe this isn't so normal, and make sports safer going forward.
Great.
Well, I think that what we call tau PET is really what's very exciting in the Alzheimer's field. And it's also it's the same thing that measures tau in chronic traumatic encephalopathy. And we're just beginning to start to do that. I think the reason why we're so excited about it in the Alzheimer's field is that tau PET has the potential to be what is called a surrogate outcome measure in a clinical trial. So let me just explain, I know it'll take another minute, what a surrogate measure is. When we had HIV epidemic just beginning back in the 80s, and people started doing antiviral trials, the way that they could show whether the antivirals were working is by how long people lived. So essentially, lifespan was the outcome measure that determined if the treatment worked. And that was a very crude measure, because lifespan depends on many things. It depends on the health of the subject. It's not just dependent on the HIV. It's dependent on all the other things, so the kind of care they get, how much support they get, and so forth. But that's all they had in the beginning. Then somebody noticed that the CD4 lymphocyte count in the blood, a certain type of lymphocyte, went down when people had HIV because the virus attacks the CD4 lymphocyte. And then people noticed that antivirals, when they were working, the CD4 lymphocyte would start a count would go up. So it was proposed and fast-tracked to the FDA that instead of using lifespan or hospitalizations or quality of life measures, that why not simply use the CD4 lymphocyte count as what's called a surrogate outcome measure to do a clinical trial. That gives you a much faster result and a much more reliable result, because the CD4 lymphocytes were very specifically affected by HIV. So what they were able to do then is do clinical trials much faster, much less expensively, and just accelerate effective treatment for HIV, because they had a surrogate outcome measure for health benefit, which was the CD4 lymphocyte count. In Alzheimer's, we're still using cognition as the outcome measure. What we need is some kind of a biomarker which reflects disease progression and that would respond to a treatment. And we think that the amount of tau in the brain, because it spreads as the disease progresses, might be a surrogate outcome measure. And there's huge excitement about that.
Great. Gil, last word here.
I have a 3-year-old and a 6-year-old, so our dinner conversation is pretty fragmented.
Not about tau imaging.
I think this is kind of a Taoist table, but tau is important not only in CTE and in Alzheimer's, but also in frontotemporal dementia, also in atypical Parkinsonian dementias like progressive supranuclear palsy and corticobasal degeneration. There's a lot of reason to believe that even if amyloid initiates or accelerates the disease, it's the spread of tau through brain networks that drives the loss of tissue and leads to symptoms. So I am also very excited about tau as a diagnostic agent to be able to detect it on PET scans, but also increasingly as a focus of therapeutic targets, because I think especially once symptoms are established, stopping the spread of tau from one neuron to the next, based on our current understanding of the disease, is a very attractive therapeutic strategy.
Great. Thank you all so much for your expertise here today.